Thank you, thank you, thank you. So welcome to CS Ed Day at Berkeley. This is the part where we do our demos and you get to see what the professors and the students have been working on the whole semester. Who is excited to be here? Who has visited Berkeley before? Welcome back. Who is applying to Berkeley? I would hope everybody. So I have a quick little story to tell you before Alexei takes over. I think it was 2 or 3 years ago, I was emceeing CS Ed Day. My name is Omoju Miller, Dr. Miller. I got my PhD from Berkeley here in computer science education, working with Dr. Dan Garcia. So I am a proud alumni of this great institution of ours. And since then, I have worked at Google. I am a data scientist and will be starting a data science fellowship in January. So data science pretty much does machine learning, some of this kind of stuff. But that's not the fun part. It's the story I'm about to tell you. It's the fun part. So 2-3 years ago, I'm over here doing my shtick. And I go on with my life. And I get an email 2 weeks ago. There is a young woman who is an undergraduate here at Berkeley who's thinking about going to grad school. So a friend of hers asked her to speak to me. So I asked her to meet me at my favorite coffee shop. Any Oakland Tech people here? So I asked her to meet me at Blue Bottle. Blue Bottle. How can you go to Oakland Tech and not go to Blue Bottle? Oh. Oops. Sorry. So she meets me at Blue Bottle, and she's talking and talking, and she said, oh, by the way, I saw you at CS Ed Day, and I thought, oh, wow, I could go to Berkeley just like you. And now she's a student here. So I'm saying this whole thing to say that CS Ed Day is a very effective way to get to know the campus, a very effective way to learn about the kinds of things that we're doing, and a great motivation and encouragement if you're really interested in being in the College of Engineering and pursuing a career as an engineer, especially an engineer interested in doing social good. I strongly urge you to consider applying to Berkeley. And if you have any kind of challenges academic-wise, it's not too late. Get on Khan Academy. They have all their resources completely free, especially for the SATs. It is completely free. So there is no excuse that I shouldn't see some of you here next year on this stage presenting your own work. With that, let's give it up for Alexei.
All right. Let's see.
Hello?
Okay. So good morning. My name is Alexei Efros. I am a professor here in the EECS Computer Science Department. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about some of the stuff that I do. I work in computer vision and computer graphics. Before we start, there is a recent study that shows that people who sit in the front row get one letter grade higher than people who sit in the back row. And in fact, for every row, you get like, you know, 0.2% higher GPA. So people in the back, just come over to the front. We still have about 10 seats. And you know, raise your grade by doing nothing. All right. So, what I do is trying to make the computers understand the visual world and also recreate the visual world. So, it is actually very hard for computers to understand the visual world. And it's hard for us to understand it because we do it so effortlessly. So I want to show you a little bit of why this is hard, and then we're going to go and see some of the cool things that one can do. So when you look at a picture like this, what do you see? You see a big panorama, you got cars, pedestrians, buildings, roads, and you can understand what this is, right? Even though this is a two-dimensional surface, what you can see is a three-dimensional world. What does the computer see? Well, the computer is usually going to be sliding a little square window around the image, say, looking for pedestrians. It's if it's a self-driving car, it's looking for pedestrians. what it's going to see, not this picture, it's going to see something like this, right? This is what the computer is seeing. And so when you ask the computer, show me some pedestrians, okay, so it will find a few pedestrians for you, but it's going to miss a couple. And most embarrassingly, it's going to do what's called false detections. It's going to find a pedestrian over there at the top of the lamppost. And you think, this is so stupid. But remember, the computer is also only seeing this tiny little bit. And so, you know, if I were to, show you, what we humans can do, right? So you say, oh, look at this. This is a beautiful, soccer game. Americans playing against Germany. Let's look at this German player over there. How many people can tell me, is he a big guy or kind of a small kid? Okay. Broad shoulders or thin shoulders? Broad shoulders. Okay. Some people also say, what is he doing? What's his pose? He's like looking backwards. He's probably checking out the other guy here, right? Some people also say, oh, he's tired. I gave this talk in Germany, and they said, oh, this is player so-and-so. And look at this. The guy has no head. He has a mess of pixels for legs. It's basically almost no information in there. And yet, our human brain is able to infer all of this story. You told me a whole story about this guy, even though visually there is very little in it. So this is the challenge for the computer. We are just very good at taking very sparse and noisy measurements and reconstructing reality. Here is another example for you. This is a blurry video of that my friend Antonio Taralba did. Here is our friend Rob Fergus working at MIT on his computer, listening to the headphones. It's very blurry video, but all of you guys can infer what's going on here, right? And in fact, I claim that you infer a little bit more than is there, because this is the actual video. So there is Rob talking to his shoe. Now he's going to put on his beer cans, and he's going to type on the trash can using the mouse stapler and check out the printer. Okay? So what this is showing is how good our visual system is at hallucinating the world given very little information. And this is what makes it hard for computers to be able to walk around and understand and recognize objects and navigate, because computers will have to do the same thing, to infer the state of the world from very noisy information. Worse yet, as I mentioned, the world is we see images. Images are two-dimensional. But the world that those images depict is actually three-dimensional. So for example, these two red dots, they're close in the image, and they're also, close in space. They're not far from each other. These two dots are equally close in the image, but very far in space, right? They're maybe hundreds of meters apart, right? But on the image plane, they look the same. And this brings us to another very big challenge. The world is three-dimensional, but what is being seen is actually a two-dimensional projection. We're losing a third dimension. The whole dimension is getting lost. Okay, so you get a little bit of it back with two eyes, but you close one eye and you can still see things, you can still navigate, it's maybe not so easy, but it's doable. So we're getting rid of the whole dimension, and this makes it a really hard problem. In fact, it's so hard, it's mathematically impossible. Because if you're given a two-dimensional projection, to try to infer what was the three-dimensional structure that produced this might look simple, but actually, there is infinitely many solutions. There are infinitely many three-dimensional structures that will give you the same two-dimensional projections. So it's mathematically impossible. So how do we actually do it? Well, if we lived in a world, in some abstract world with little pieces of matter just floating in space, we wouldn't have a chance. But luckily, we live in our structured world, There is gravity, there is surfaces. Surfaces are either horizontal or vertical. They are structured, and this is the way that we are training ourselves, humans are training ourselves to understand this noisy two-dimensional signal to understand a three-dimensional world. And this is what we will have to do to computers to be able to try to make them understand the three-dimensional world. And this is why machine learning is so important, because it allows computers to try to infer from very noisy sparse signal what the state of the visual world is. Okay? So here is a little example of some of my work a few years back, where we try to do this automatically. So given an image, we try to label automatically using machine learning what are the surfaces of the image. So here the blue is the sky, the green is the ground plane, and red is basically all the vertical structures. Okay, so it's a very simple thing. You just color it into three things. And it turns out this is not a very simple problem for a computer, but you know, you can do it, and you can see it's not very clean. But then we can say, okay, now we can find the intersection between the horizontal and the vertical surfaces. And then we can do what these photo pop-ups are. You make a photo pop-up out of a piece of paper. So basically we're gonna try to make a photo pop-up of our image and try to make it into 3D. And this is the result that you have here. So this is a picture I took in Oxford, England. Single image. And then we have a computer automatically infer a three-dimensional structure. It's a very simple one. We have a plane, we have another plane here, another plane here, another plane here. So it's like four planes. But it gets us enough to infer, a plausible three-dimensional world from a single image. And you can see that, yeah, some of the buildings are basically plastered to the ground. So plastered to the planar surface. So it's not super clean, but it's kind of encouraging that we can do this from just a single image. Here is another example. Okay. All right. In fact, we can do it not just with images. I mean, single image, you say, well, you should have just gone there and take a video instead, right? But it's hard to take a video of this, Dutch painting that is, that's hundreds of years old. And yet, in my computational photography class, which I hope you take if you come to Berkeley, we show how to basically go into this painting and create novel views within this painting. In fact, one of the students in my class kind of made a little, pop-up in 3D, and then she actually, printed it out and made a little, physical model of this painting, okay? How do you do this? Turns out that the math is not that complicated, okay? It's still math. You have to know math, but it's not difficult math. The math is called image rectification. So let's say you have an image like this. And let's say that you want to figure out what would this image look like if your camera were looking down onto the floor, okay? So you want to just rotate the camera so it looks down into the floor, okay? And you think, wow, this is impossible. Turns out it's actually possible. So what do we mean by looking down into the floor? Let's pick four points on the ground, these four points P, okay? P1, P2, P3, P4. And then we're just gonna say, to make the camera look down, what this means is that those four points, they need to be aligned in the square like this. Because if I look down, hopefully those tiles are going to look square. They're not square right now because of the foreshortening, because of the perspective effect. But if we'll force the camera to look down, they should look square. Okay? And then it's basically a question of finding a homography H that transforms those points P into points P prime that are square. And voila, you have your image. So what is a homography? It's nothing but a simple 3x3 matrix. How many of you have heard of a matrix? Some people. Matrix is basically like an Excel spreadsheet in a math form, right? It's basically 9 numbers. So you get those 9 numbers, and you're done. You can do all of this, and this is like assignment 4 in my undergraduate course, okay? And once you do that, you can show off to all of your art and humanities friends, because here's an example of a painting. It's important Renaissance Italian painting. They were into perspective. They liked perspective a lot. All these lines, all these patterned floors. And so the art historians are actually very interested in what is the pattern on the floor? Look at this beautiful pattern. But what is it? It's hard to see. And the art historians actually spend whole years trying to figure out what that pattern is and trying to reconstruct it by hand. But guess what? With our little homography trick, the 3x3 matrix, ta-da, we can do it in a second. So this is a rectification, basically rotating the camera to seeing what this pattern is. You get it in a second. Okay? Some other examples of what people in my class have done, again, using this trick of homographies. Exactly the same formula, 3x3 homography matrix, over and over and over again. Come to Berkeley, take my computational photography class. You can do something like this too. This is another project. This is now a graduate student, Natasha, who was in charge of this program. A little bit more tricky than a homography, but still totally doable. Let's see if this
works. Software can move, rotate, and scale image segments, but only in 2 dimensions. We present an approach that uses publicly available 3D models to allow 3-dimensional manipulation of photographs. We adjust the stock model's geometry and texture to match the photographed pixels and estimate the illumination. We can now have 3D control of the object and reveal hidden parts. Our approach allows users to create effects that are difficult or even impossible using traditional photography. We can now dramatically change the photograph's narrative and create animations. Visit our website for more details.
Okay. Okay. So one more thing. I have 4 minutes to show you. And this is actually, I'm going to explain to you my PhD thesis. I did my PhD at Cal, and I'm going to explain to you in one slide. Okay. Ready for this? So the idea, what my goal was to do is what's called texture synthesis. So you see a little piece of texture. And you want to make more of it. Let's say you want to tile your video game with texture. So you want to make more of it, but you don't want something like this, because this looks too repetitive. What you want is you want something like this. Okay? So how do you do that? So here is the algorithm in one slide. Let's say that you're creating, synthesizing an image one pixel at a time. And now you already gotten a bunch of pixels synthesized, and now you want to synthesize this pixel P. You need to create this new pixel P. What do? Well, you have an input texture image, the small patch of texture that you want to synthesize. What you do is you look at the neighborhood around the pixel you want to synthesize, P, and you try to match it. You try to find similar neighborhoods in your input image. Okay, and here we have 4 similar neighborhoods. And then you just pick one at random, and you take that central pixel and you stick it into P. And that's how you synthesize P. And that's it. Now you just do it for next pixel, next pixel, next pixel, and you synthesize your whole image like this. Okay? And then you can vary the size of your context to make it bigger or smaller, kind of a context. And you can see how the neighborhood window, if the window is very small, you basically it figures out, okay, there are some kind of snakes running through this plane. But if you make the window bigger, say, oh, it's little circles. Oh, the circles don't like each other. Oh, it's a pattern, okay? So the same algorithm, very simple, but the size of the scale of the window controls it. And then you have results like this, result like this, and then results like this. And sometimes it doesn't work. But most of the time it works. And we can also try to do this for bigger images. So for example, for bigger images, it's a little bit tricky. So you want to say, you know, I want to get rid of this building over here. Okay, that's easy. I go to Photoshop, I get rid of it. But now you have a hole. How do you fill in the hole? You can try to do the synthesis thing, but it's a lot of stuff to synthesize. It might not look very good. So instead, what we do is we use what's called a data-driven approach. We download 2 million images from the internet. Took us a while. And then we find the most similar image to the one with the hole. And then just basically use the most similar image to try to fill in the hole. And a little bit magic, and there you go. And that's another one. You can use multiple, right? You can use this one. Sometimes it doesn't quite work. But, you know, this is not so bad. There's another one. We can get rid of this crane here. Easy. So why does it work? And look at the nearest neighbors it got. Look at the most similar images. Like, it's very, very similar. This is because our visual world is actually, you know, not that different. It's different city, different river, but they look very similar. So it's reasonable to make sense why it fills in the hole. If you don't like a view out of your window, the hill doesn't look that good, it can give you a new hill. Or there's a development, your favorite beach, I can get rid of that for you. And again, you know, why does it work? It's basically, it works because of the data, right? So you have this image, you have a, we looked at a big data set of 20,000 images before, and you know, it just didn't look so good. The nearest neighbors, the nearest matches were not so near. And so once we went to 2 million images, exactly the same algorithm, worked much better. Okay, so that's all I have. If you want to know more, come to Berkeley. Thank you very much. Any last questions before we switch?
Hello, everybody. Yes. I'm a computer security researcher. My name's Nick. I do a lot of work in computer security, and I also teach. And yes, indeed, I am one of the Defense Against the Dark Arts instructors here. And I am the Severus Snape of the department. You want to know how to... Little too evil at times, so, but in the end, I hope I'm a good guy. So, rather than talk about a lot of details on computer security and the like, I'm gonna give you some defense lessons, and how we build systems implies how to defend. How many hate passwords? If your hand is not up, I'm assuming you love passwords. Passwords are evil, passwords are vile, passwords are disgusting. But how do they work? Well, you have your silly little web page, and it has the username and the password, and you type in the password, and it's sent to the server, And you should see that little lock icon in the browser that means there's lots of crypto that you learn about in the advanced class protecting it so somebody listening in doesn't see. And then the server over here takes your username and your password, which is, of course, P-A-S-S-W-0-R-D. I know people. This is one of the most common passwords. And it checks to see that the password you typed in is the password associated with your username. Now, okay, here's the problem. You don't just use that password on one site. You use that password all over the place. Who is willing to admit that they use the same password on multiple sites? How many know you are not supposed to do that, but do it anyway? Okay. So, since we've established the ground rules that you reuse your password, what happens if somebody evil takes control over this server and it just had recorded, oh, when you signed up, your password is password? You're screwed. Now, the problem is sites are supposed to do something better, but a lot of them don't even do that. If ever you get to a website and you click on the I lost my password and it gives you back the password you gave it, it's completely insecure and whoever designed that site should be flogged because you don't need to store passwords. What instead we could store is something that is a one-way operation. So it's, in computer security, we call this a hash. So you can take a string, you grind at it with a cryptographic hash function, and you get something, another string. And the key is this is not reversible. So password always maps to say 3A715X2 blah, blah, blah. That's a hash function. The thing is you see something that still doesn't work? What if somebody takes over the site and sees this? You're done because, well, they can also compute password hash to this. And in fact, this is called password cracking. So you'd have this dictionary of all the common passwords. And your passwords are in those dictionaries unless you've actually randomly created a password. And so what the bad guys do is they take this list, they break into a site, get this list of usernames and hashes of passwords, and, well, just grind through and go, oh, I've already pre-computed that password hashes to this, so if I see this, it's password. Ugh. So, let's say a site is a little bit better. Well, what they do is they add a salt, like the username. And they use a function that takes a long, long time, like a good fraction of a second. And so if you have password and somebody else has the same password, their hash is different. So they see a hash of like 5731X2 blah, blah, blah. Now, in this case, the bad guys will still break your password if it's bad because they just simply go, for each user, let's try the top 1,000 passwords or top 10,000 passwords. And, well, they'll still break it. So ideally, your instructions are supposed to be come up with a good password that can't be guessed. Don't you hate this? Because every single fracking site has its own requirement for a password. So what you need to do is start thinking about security. And there's one big problem on securing computer systems that's actually very different from the rest of your life. So how many have heard the parable of the hikers and the bear? Okay, well, myself and a friend, we were out in the woods going for a nice hike, and we heard this roar behind us, and this huge bear looms up and looks like it's going to attack us. And so what I do is I stop, and I get down, and I tie my shoelaces, make sure they're really good. And my friend's going, "Oh my God, there's a bear. Why are you stopping to tie your shoes?" I don't have to outrun the bear. I just have to outrun you. Now, that is a parable that is remarkably true in your real life. So my door lock is not that strong because there's a window next to it. But I know not all my neighbors lock their doors, so some random burglar is going to go and go for the unlocked door. The problem is this does not apply in computer security, because computers are really good at doing boring things again and again and again, and lots of them. And so you can't just be better than 10% of the population that's bear bait in the computer world. You actually need to be secure, because otherwise the computers are going to get you. Because the attackers, rather than going after individual people, they're computer geeks. And so what they do is they program up their computer to say, well, for everybody on the planet who's vulnerable to this, let's go get them. Yes, it's awful. Because worse, they figured out how to make money at it, so they'll take your email account and strip it for parts. And so as a consequence, you yourself need good security. And so let's actually look at how the Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher handles his passwords. Well, I have a couple of good passwords. These are random five-word phrases, literally random five words that I've memorized. And these are the keys to the kingdom. If somebody knows my random five words, but I don't actually use them at very many places. I only use them to log into my computer, log into my phone, and log into a tool in my browser called a password manager. And what a password manager is, the one I use is 1Password, but there's lots of other ones, is it sits on your computer, and it has this huge data of information that is all locked up with your passphrase. So if you don't know the passphrase or don't have control over my computer, you can't see what's in here. But what's in here is things like Amazon, the password is 7A53, 20 random characters. Nobody is going to guess 20 random characters. Nobody, however, is going to remember 20 random characters. But I don't have to, because the password manager handles all of that for me. So every site uses a different password generated randomly by the password manager, and I don't remember it at all. I let the computer take care of the hard stuff. And I only need to remember my good password, the one that's five words long. And so how did I learn to remember my good password? What? Not quite. I didn't tattoo it on my arm, but close. How many have heard the advice, don't write down passwords? That's actually bad advice, because it needs a caveat. Dumb people write down their password and stick it on a post-it note on their monitor. Smart people write down their password and stick it on a piece of paper in their wallet, because this device is something that's already used to carrying around really valuable pieces of paper. You know how to protect this. And then after a few days or a week, when you finally memorized your password, well, then you chew it up and eat it because, well, that's a great data destruction policy. And that is a bit of defense against the dark arts. But let's do a little bit more and have to deal with credit cards. So this you're going to need once you go off to college because you will have a credit card. And more importantly, you can sound really smart to your parents that, hey, we learned some practical real-world computer security. Firstly, practical real-world thing number one. Credit card fraud is not supposed to be your problem. It is supposed to be the problem of the bank and the credit card company. And they have legal obligations to reject fraudulent transactions. And they do a reasonably good job of it. But they aren't perfect. And occasionally you will have a fraudulent transaction show up on your credit card. And one of the joys in securing a system is making it somebody else's problem. And so if there's a fraudulent transaction on my credit card, I call up the credit card company and say, hey, this is a fraudulent transaction. They go, okie doke, we'll take care of it. How do they take care of it? They then usually go after the merchant. But there's a big difference between a credit card and a debit card. That with a credit card, I take that money and, well, it's not my money. It's the credit card company's money. And as a consequence, they still have to get the money from me. And so in case of fraud, it's not really a problem. It's just an annoyance. When my credit cards have gotten compromised by random hackers, I've had to change some auto bills and the like, but that's about it. However, if it's a debit card, so if it's an ATM card with, say, a Visa or MasterCard logo, well, that's your money. That until you actually get through, your money's gone and you have to claw it back. And let me tell you, it's a lot easier to keep from giving money to a bank than to get money back from a bank. And so as a consequence, my policy, which is directly applied, is my credit cards I use everywhere. I'm nice and happy with them. But my debit card is actually ATM only. It will not work as a Visa card. It will only work in ATM machines. And I will only use it in ATM machines belonging to my bank, and I will check to make sure there isn't a skimmer installed, a device that sits and reads the card as it gets put in. Because, well, in the end, I'd get my money back, theoretically, hopefully. But the cost of the fraud is a lot harder because I have to drag the money back from the bank. And so this is why you should tell your parents, credit card? Sure, use it. Debit card? Only use it in physical ATMs of the bank. And this is because of what the attackers do. And this is what I work on, is just various dark arts defense. And so that's basically my life. I do a lot of stuff on cybercrime. I do a lot of work in that area. Privacy, all sorts of other things. And you come to Berkeley, you can have fun working at that space too. And so questions before I move it on to the next one? They tend to stick onto the card slot. So I just grab the card slot out of habit. Because what they do is they have these plastic molds that go over the card slot and read your card as it gets stuck in. And so by just doing a little grab, that gets almost all of them. And because I'm only using ATMs that are belonging to my bank themselves with security cameras, I pretty much hope that they'd notice somebody coming up to it and sticking something inside and tampering with it. So that's how that works.
One more question.
So you're saying that you don't pay for stuff with your debit card. You
or my credit card. I use my credit card quite happily to pay for stuff because in case of fraud, it's the bank's problem, it's not mine. And the number one rule in computer security is, when impossible, make it somebody else's problem.
Thank you. All right, so next up is projects from UC Berkeley's CS10.
We have one of them, or we have one of the mics.
Is that all you need? Or you need more mics? Because we have this.
Yeah.
This is also working.
Okay. This one, I think you just need to take it off. And then you can use that one. I need this one.
Hello? All right. Hello, hello. Hi. Hello. Hi. So while everyone is getting settled in and the students are getting ready to present, I wanted to introduce myself and the course. Hi. My name is Adam. I am one of the two head TAs for Computer Science 10 here at UC Berkeley. Go Bears. This class is a introduction class to computer science principles. And it's a little different than a lot, well, I would say a lot different than the other computer science classes on campus. Firstly, we're the only class that is strictly for non-majors. It does not count for computer science credit later on in the major. This is strictly an exploratory class for intended mostly for non-majors or those with little to no computer science experience to get a feel for not only how to code, why it is important to learn how to code, but also some of the big computer science principles that may not even be directly related to coding specifically, such as the internet, security. There's a lot of really, really cool things we do in this course. We teach not only Snap, which is a variation and an extension of Build Your Own Blocks, or BYOB, and we also teach Python, which is a really, really awesome language. I hope everyone gets a chance to learn at some point. It is also the language of the first computer science course in the 61 series, or first classes you need to take for the computer science major here at UC Berkeley. And with that said, we have an awesome slate of presentations for you directly from this semester. So all of the students that you're going to be hearing from today have taken the course all through the semester. They have their final in a week, which is unfortunate, but they're still here and they want to show you their awesome projects that they've been working on for the past 3 weeks or so. So with that said, I'm gonna turn the mic over to our first presenters.
All right, hi, how's everybody doing? I mean, I have a final in a week, so I don't know how bad it could get, right? My name is Christian Vasquez, and this is my partner, Carlos Ortega. And we're here to present to you our final project for CS10. So before I begin, who here in the crowd loves playing video games? Yeah, that's what it's all about, right? Okay. All right, there you go. All right. So me and my partner, Carlos, love playing video games. But one of the questions that we came in coming into this class was, how do we go from code, which looks a lot like this with a lot of lines and numbers and all these weird functions and stuff, how do we go from that to like the visual aspect of video games that's presented to all of us as consumers, right? With the nice visual effects, the nice like action, everything, right? So for our final project, we decided to create the game Snake, our own variation of it, through our code, through the language that we learned at the end of our semester, which is Python. So who here has played like a variation of Snake? Yeah, a couple of you, right? So you would recall that it's a pretty simple game, but using the visual libraries from Pygame and the language from Python, we were able to create this. This is CS10 Python, named after the language that we use, as well as the visual libraries from Pygame. So one of the things that you could tell right out from the start from running our program is that, and it's not often found in a lot of Snake games, by the way, is a difficulty. One thing that we implemented in our project was a set of three difficulties: normal, hard, and extreme. Each level of difficulty rises the frames per second of the level. That means that each image that is flashed from each screen increases, thus it makes it a lot harder for you to move your snake and get like the points and everything. Another thing that difficulty does in our game is that it increases the point system. So in the beginning, it starts off with 10 points for normal, 20 points for hard, and 30 points for extreme. Now, I'm done talking, so I'm gonna just let my partner Carlos take it away and show off our game. Right. Yeah. All right. Y'all seem to be getting pretty excited about this project. Wow. Yeah, can I get a clap for my partner, Carlos? Yeah. Awesome job. All right, y'all seem to really enjoy that, but let's see if Carlos can take it up a notch with, let's see. Here we go. All right. Another, there it is, Carlos Ortega, once again. Amazing. So this is our final project. And it's amazing, it's fun, this is what we were able to try out, but how does it actually work, right? How did we, as students, use the techniques that we learned first in Snap to apply them in Python to create our game? So right now, a lot of you might look at this and you're just like, oh, how do they go from this to, like, again, the visual aspect of the game, right? So it's kind of hard and difficult, but it's actually not that bad if you look at it a little bit closer, right? So if you like scroll down, there's like a couple of things like define difficulty. Like right from the start, you could tell right here, right? Difficulty, frames per second, right? Get frames per second. In the beginning, you see different colors being defined, right? And as you keep scrolling down to the code, you start seeing that it's like running loops and in different things. And really, it's not as difficult as it seems, right? And you could tell that you could go easily from a game like, you could create a game like Snake or Python, in Python, it's not that bad, and it's really fun, and you could actually learn a lot, right? So I hope that you all enjoy our project, and you understood that, you know, how, maybe like a little sneak peek of how you can go maybe from like this to like the visual aspect of it, right? And it's a lot of fun playing the game, but it's a hell of a lot more fun creating one, right? So I want to challenge y'all, if you ever take like a CS class and wherever you all go, it's like, it's really fun creating games, creating functions, and I hope y'all take the opportunity to create your own games, your own functions, your own whatever, right? Because you could really create anything in CS. So thank you, my name is Christian. This is Carlos, this is our project.
Good job, guys. That is strong.
All right, we're going to be hearing next from a group that worked on another game, a different game, and in this for this project, they worked in Snap, which is the language we predominantly use throughout the semester. So I'm going to hand it off to the guys.
Introduce yourself.
Hey, guys, I'm Michael. So I'm going to talk to you guys about my CS experience before I came to Berkeley. This is my first CS class at Berkeley. Before Berkeley, in junior year of high school, I took AP Computer Science A, but I kind of forgot it, so I didn't feel comfortable moving on to the 61 series, so that's why I decided to take CS 10. And it really helped me remember the ideas that were taught in AP Computer Science, which is really the ground level you need to build up from to be a computer science major.
My name is Joaquin. Coming into Berkeley, I had zero experience with computer science. So I heard about CS10 during CALSA. That's orientation, and I thought I should give it a try.
Hello, my name is Marvin. In high school of senior year, I took APCS, and coming into Berkeley, I decided to take CS10 just so I could get like a good ground base, and I've had a great experience so far. So without further ado, let's explain our game.
Okay, so our game is Battleship. I'm sure most of you guys have played it before. So we start out with the start screen, obviously, with three different modes. Easy, medium, hard. We're gonna go with easy today. So you start out with placing your ships, right, in Battleship. So it gives you options to place it either vertically or horizontally. And it basically just checks the board to see if you can place the ship where there is nothing been placed yet. And you do that for all your ships. And after you're done with your ships, your artificial intelligence places his ships on his own without you knowing like which ship is placed where, so it can be a fair game. So you can see that as we're placing the ships, it's showing the first letter of the ship there, so A for aircraft carrier, B for battleship, and each with varying length. And the code that is used to place the AI ships are actually pretty similar to the way we place our own ships. So,
all right, yeah, so after you finish selecting all the coordinates in your own grid, we had a little code that had the AI select randomly where they want to place their battleships. And it's not going to be shown on the screen, obviously, or else that'd be too easy. So right now the game has started, and the AI goes first. So it just guessed F10. So what do you think we should guess next? Just a random coordinate. Anybody?
A1.
Right, I heard A1. Let's see A1. Okay, so capital letter. A1. Oh, we missed. Okay, so now it's the AI's turn. They guess B1. And then it's our turn again. Coordinates. All right, I heard C3. All right, settle down. All right. So yeah, Battleship can be kind of slow in the beginning, but once you kind of get that first hit, it gets a little bit faster. All right, E9. Okay. You want the opponent's board? So, what we did, okay, so, wait, no, go to variables, opponent board. Okay, so we're just going to kind of take a little shortcut, and we're going to see where the AI put its coordinates. So, just to kind of speed it up a little bit, you know. So what we did was, if the AI placed a battleship in a single coordinate, we would see in this list that it'd be marked as a letter. And that tells us like there's this battleship there. So if we typed in C1, for example, we get a hit. Yay! Hey, okay. So if you can close the opponent board, like make it smaller. Make the opponent board smaller. So our chances right now aren't super great. Like the AI is missing quite a bit, but if it were to hit, then we have an algorithm that has a guess to the right, guess to the left, guess up and down. And we keep on playing the game until all battleships are hit, or until one person wins. And that's pretty much how the game works. Yeah.
Good job.
Forget to introduce yourself.
Yeah. Hey guys, I'm Varda and this is Batul, and I just want to get a sense of the room. How many of you have like programmed before? Okay, that's a lot of you, and that's like more than what we did. Like we came into Cal with no coding experience and no intention to major in computer science, but after taking this class, like we realized how powerful CS is. So we're just gonna do a demo of our final project. How many of you have heard of Akinator? Okay, so it's like kind of inspired by that. It's a guessing game. Where our genie, given a scope of items, it guesses what you're thinking of by asking you yes or no questions. Yeah, so can someone shout out like some item? Bear? Okay, go Bears, right? Okay. So, is it an animal?
Yes.
Yeah. Is it a pet?
No.
Yes. Right? Yeah. No. 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 Okay. Is it a bear that resembles Oski? Yeah. Yeah, I guess is. Do you want to do something else? We can do another one. Do you guys want to think of a what? Okay, the donkey? Okay, yeah. Okay. Fireman. Is it a farm animal or a wild animal? Wait, just And then other thing we want you guys to take away from this is that block-based programming like Snap is like as powerful as Python or any other language. Yeah. Thank you.
And then
hey, right, cool.
So here's yours and feel free to start.
Hey guys, how y'all doing? All right, so my name is Basil.
My name is Kizer.
And we did, for our CS10 final project, we did the game of checkers, so through Python. So basically, checkers, you know, it's a game that seems really simple to most of us because most of the time when we're playing it, when you're at school, it's just like a mindless activity, right? You're doing it, it's really easy, it's really simple. But I think one of the coolest things that you'll learn if you do computer science is that when you actually start to break down the game into its simplest parts, there's a lot more that goes into every single game and every single program than you would originally think. So if you look at this program for Python, why don't you go ahead and play it. If you look at this program for Python, basically what we did is we broke up the question of checkers into five separate questions, which basically involved, you know, like we had to track where each checker was on the board. That was a fundamental function. We had to be able to determine whether the next move the checker would make is a valid move. We had to create an algorithm for the computer to play against the player. We had to determine when it is that you win or lose. And ultimately, when you do a lot of that stuff, you get a really nice appreciation for the concept of abstraction in computer science, which is when you sort of shroud something that's very complex, shroud its inner workings in favor of something that appears to be far more simple. So Just key takeaway, since I don't got a lot of time, you can see how it's played. It's played like any other game of checkers. But what I would recommend for your high schoolers, right? Yeah. All right, for sure. So what I would recommend for all you guys is I don't think I was any smarter than any of you when I started computer science. I don't think I'm any smarter now. But so for high schoolers, like, you can get into coding right away. You should get into it. You should try to learn it as much as you can and play with it. You know, do stuff yourself. There's Codecademy online. And computer science really does enable you to do a lot of things, be able to create. So regardless of what field you want to go into, you want to go into biology, you want to go into business, you want to go into whatever you want to get into, coding is the future. The economy is getting automated. So just ride that wave and learn coding. You'll have a lot of fun doing it. All right, thank you.
Hi, my name is Isabella, and this is my partner, Ada. We took CS10 this semester, and this is actually our midterm project. What we did was we coded a program to run with the watercolor bot. So this is a live example of how you can program code to connect with hardware, and that code will tell the hardware what to do. So while they're connecting it, yep, so this is what we have. So it's hard to see it from here, but basically what our grid does, it simulates the dimensions of the watercolor bot. So we're going to run this. And you can paint people or patterns with this. So let's start with a pattern. And we're going to start with a pattern that we named Hexagon Mountain. And basically these patterns are all recursive, meaning that they call on each other to do things. So how many levels would you like the Hexagon Mountain to have? We're going to do 5 levels. And then size, let's do 100. And for the proportion, or for the color, what color would you like to do?
Red.
All right, let's do color red. That would be number 1. So this is a preview. And it's a little bit small, so you can change it, and then we can make it bigger. But we'd like to move on and show you the person.
Let's just move on to the person.
Yeah. So we're going to start this code over again. And this time we're going to show you how to repainted the people. So you can choose a person. Polygon head. Let's do 5 sides. Sound good?
Yeah.
All right. 5. What size? Let's do. Okay, type it in. All right. And then color. Okay, that's 6. No, that's 4. What is? Okay, let's do 4. That's green, a green head. And body. Triangle body, 3 sides. Okay. And just go ahead and type in all the sizes for me. So yeah, so basically in the end, you paint it, you put in all these sides, you put the length of the arms, we're gonna do 70. And for the legs, we're gonna do 80. And for the color of the legs?
Purple,
okay, number 6, that's purple. And this is a preview. So we'd like to show you how it actually paints. This is a snapshot of us working on it. Yay, it works. Okay, it took a long time for this to work. It's not that easy, but it's actually really fun once you get it to work. Yep, so that's our midterm project with the watercolor bot.
All right, everyone. So I hope everyone got a taste of CS10 projects, what we do in the class. Thank you very much for your patience, and hopefully you learned a little bit.
All right, everybody, give it up for CS10. We were supposed to have a break, but we're running behind, so we're going to grind through. The next group coming up, can you open that door and let them in, please? The next group coming up is called UC Bug. They are our animation group. How many of you guys like animation? Have you seen, what is the best animated film this year you've seen? Moana? For me, it's Cuba with the two strings. That was awesome. And then Finding Rory or Dory, I couldn't watch that. Speak up. Oh, well, Claymation, sorry. Cuba with the two strings is Claymation. All right, come on in, guys. So this group, they are a group that works on things like that. So if you're interested in animation, if you're interested in storytelling, if you like your linear algebra, this is the group for you. You can come here and do this, and eventually you probably end up at Pixar, LucasArts, Disney, and you're building the next stories. So, hi, UC Bug. Wait, there should be another mic.
Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Okay, so we're UC Bug, as our other presenter kind of introduced us, but basically we are the 3D modeling and animation decal, and what a decal is basically we're all students here, and we just teach this course for one semester, and at the end of the semester you get to create your own final film. So how exciting is that? You get to create your own Moana, you get to create the next Outside In, the sequel to Inside Out. Wow, how cool is that? So what we teach is the entire animation pipeline, and this is what we're also going to demo today. So the entire animation pipeline goes from pre-production to production to post-production. And we're going to talk about, you know, what pre-production is mostly, what production includes, you know, just animation, modeling after pre-production, after you have everything set up. Then you have post-production, where you set up your entire video stuff, and wow, now you have your final film. Woohoo! So without further ado, let's talk about pre-production. So, in UC Bug, we start out with a story pitch. Everyone has a story pitch. You have a story in mind. So, for example, maybe my story is about, no, not yet, is about these raccoons. And these raccoons, you know, just go into a house, and they decide.
Can we be quiet so we can give her our attention, please?
Thank you. Okay, so story pitch. You start out with a story. Everyone has a story in UC Bug that they pitch to the entire class. So maybe my story is about raccoons. I have three raccoons in my story, and I want them to go into a house to steal some stuff because that's fun, and I think that raccoons are just sneaky and devious things. So I want to make a story about them. So these raccoons go into a house, and they decide that they want to steal a sock from a dryer. They leave successfully stealing that sock from the dryer, and then the homeowners come back and they say, where did my sock go? You know, the story of the missing sock. Wow. But of course, when you're working with a bunch of different people, stories do change, and now the story is about these three raccoons who actually find this key, or they're trying to find this key in a house, and there's this cat opponent that just kind of tries to stop them, and you know, to put this into these drawings, because of course animation is a very visual medium, we want to put these into drawings. So I'm going to draw out these three raccoons just scurrying around and, you know, just trying to overcome this obstacle of the cat. So I'm going to have these series of drawings. These are called storyboards, these major drawings that depict your story. And afterwards, after I have my story solidified, you know, it's clean, I want to put this into a video format so I could see kind of how timing works, see how the punchline goes, stuff like that. So if Oliver wants to play the animatic here. think this is a sound thing. Let's start from the beginning. Yeah, it doesn't have sound until. So, as you can see, that these drawings just come into video format, so you can kind of see what our final result is going to be when we actually put this into a 3D animation program. So, once we have our story solidified, we have these things called character sheets. So, you know, afterwards you want to see how your characters are going to look like. So, we have three raccoons. This one's called Tufts, this one's called Sneaks, this one's called Smarty. So you can kind of see how their characteristics kind of embody these names, where Tufts is really, really buff, where Sneaks is kind of sneaky, which is, you know, characterized by his bandana. Then there's Smarty with his smart glasses. So you want to kind of have these solidified character designs so you can kind of see them from the front, side, and back. So you can kind of put that into the 3D program and see, you know, how 2D art translates into 3D art. So this is just the pre-production pipeline, and if Oliver wants to start modeling some stuff in the 3D program, yeah. So Oliver's going to start modeling the set where he's going to create some stairs because there's like this scene where the raccoons just run around the stairs, so he's just going to start creating the stairs by starting out with just a simple cube. He just made a lot of edges in the cube now. And now he's selecting each face so that he can just extrude these faces, basically just duplicating a face and, you know, just stretching that out. You'll learn more if you take the class, but you can see how it's slowly turning into some stairs. And we're going to just kind of use this for our main set piece. Cool. So this is a beautiful set of stairs modeled by Oliver. Yay! Now, since we have our character sheets done, you know, everything's solidified, the 2D art's amazing, we want to create our models in 3D. So, we have this model. Right? This is a 3D model, and now Oliver's just going to sculpt some stuff into this model. So what do you guys want to see in the raccoon? Do you want him to be more buff? Want him to be... So Oliver's just going to use what's called the sculpting tool to just kind of, you know, mold this into a more refined character, including creating eyebrows for the character or also creating like muscle bulge in him, making him look stronger. So you can kind of see how if you were a artist who likes to work with clay, how this can also translate into 3D. Thank you. Yeah, I think that's it. Cool, so that's it for modeling. Now, if we want to go into animation, right?
Okay, so now we're actually gonna start talking about animation, which means basically moving stuff around. So the kind of spot, the step we're kind of skipping over is a step called rigging. So in rigging, what we're gonna do is we're actually gonna put a skeleton inside of our model. And so by moving the skeleton, we move the model. But we're gonna jump straight into animation. So I'll show you how that works. And so if you think about film, the way films work is that you have a bunch of images and they're just stacked on top of each other really, really quickly. In film, we have about 24 frames in a second, right? So we want 24 images stacked on top of each other in each second. And if we do it correctly, we get some sort of motion. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna make this raccoon wave.
So you see here, we have these controllers down here. And so what these controllers allow us to do is they allow us to move the model around. So when we grab like this guy and we want his head to be freakishly tall, we can do that. So there you go. Giraffe. Okay. Wait, does this thing? No. Okay, do it for me.
Thanks, Veronica, for holding the microphone. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna have him wave. So first thing we gotta do is we gotta get enough torque in the body to where it's believable that he can lift his paw off the floor. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna set a keyframe here at frame one. We're saying, okay, you can start at this position. Then at frame 12, which is about half a second in, thanks, Veronica, we're gonna have him move his entire upper body kind of in this direction. So when we hit the play button, we get something that looks like this. So he's rotating in that direction. Then, once the leg is basically at a straight, we have enough energy there to lift the paw off the floor and kind of move it up into the air and get ready to do the wave. So I'm gonna move the arm somewhere in this direction. Somewhere here, and then get it in kind of waving. So now when we hit play, we get something that looks like this. So that's a little bit quick for me, so I'm gonna move it over. So now you get something that looks like this. And so now to do the wave, basically all we gotta do is we gotta rotate it in two directions. So from here, we're gonna rotate him in this direction. And then a little bit later, we're gonna rotate it in this direction. So overall, we get something that looks like this. And so there you go, you have a basic wave.
So now Oliver's going to go into actually texturing the model. So now we have like this bike, that's also a really major prop in our short. So Oliver's just going to assign like some color onto this beautiful bike. So some tires are going to be rubber, right? So Oliver's just going to make that black and make that a bit rubber looking. And to do that, he's just adding this thing called a shader. And you can see that he's just tweaking these little attributes, making it black, making it less shiny, stuff like that. So now he's adding metal to the little rim, so then when you start to look at it as a render image, you can see that it'll look really beautiful because Oliver rocks. Mm-hmm. Oh, God. Never mind. Cool, so you could see that once Oliver rendered the image, you could see that the red showed up, the little black kind of showed up. If he adds a light in or something, then it'll be really nice and you can see all of the colors nicely. if he renders. So now Arthur is going to introduce us to actually lighting stuff, because basically texturing and shading, to see colors, you do need lights in them, and the different lights do affect how textures and stuff look in your final 3D world. And
So yeah, the purposes of lighting are, we have really three. So first one is, we cannot see anything without lighting. So without the lights, we can see the models in here in 3D, but the computer doesn't know how to light them, where the light comes from, how it bounces off the objects. So this is number one reason. Without the lighting, we'd have entirely black screen. And there are two more reasons to put lights in there. So first one is to accentuate what you want to have in the object. So for instance, if I have a ton of stuff in here around the bike, but I want the audience's attention to be exactly on the bike, I want to put a spotlight on it. And the second purpose for lighting is that it gives the mood. So if I make the lighting that seems happy and nice and bright, and it's a happy mood in the image, and if I make lighting like maybe like dark red and everything around it is like black, then it might make audience feel a little bit more alert about the presence of the bike. So yeah, right now we're just gonna put a spotlight in here. So we're gonna go to a certain menu and put one of the basic types of lights. And then we're gonna modify the attribute of this one to mimic a spotlight. No, that's all right. So yeah, we're just putting this light and adjusting its position. So approximately where we wanna shine it from. And we're also going to create some sort of environment for it to stand, because right now the bike is almost like floating in the air. Okay. Okay, so now when we render this image, the light will actually show up and make things look beautiful. Another effect, the next stage that we're gonna use to is the effects. So effects is things maybe like fire or explosions or water. So when you have effects, you usually simulate things. So in here, we'd like to simulate maybe exhaust coming from the back of this car. So. I'm going to go to effects menu and so what I did right now is I created kind of like a space within which all the effects are going to be allowed to exist, and then we have this thing called emitter from which the effect is going to be coming out. So we're going to place it at the end of the car in here. Okay, so now when we're gonna look at the bike, it's gonna start having an exhaust behind it. Right now, it's a little bit hard to see in this view, but you can see that out of this emitter comes kind of like a jet behind it. So this kind of like defect that with a little bit tweaking is going to look kind of like a exhaust coming from the pipe from behind of it.
Cool. So the last part of the pipeline is rendering. So basically in rendering, where you, like you might have noticed that that you know doesn't really look like your you know your common Pixar Disney movie, right? It looks like the kind of process of the pipeline that's last is a process called rendering. And basically what rendering does is it takes into account all the different materials and all different lights that you have in the scene and calculates all the different physics of the light bounces for us. And basically that's what kind of makes movies look beautiful. So here is actually the final rendered short that we've been kind of doing so far.
Okay, cool. So thanks everyone for letting us present. Now we have like 5 minutes to show some more films, if you're interested in that.
Yeah. Cool. How long what?
That was a whole year.
Yeah. Oh, this is, oh, you just have them in here. Is the corgi one in here?
Yeah. Right. Play the, play Paper Magician too. Yeah.
Really?
Spoilers. Yeah, I like Paper Magician.
Guys, all right, everyone, I need you to get your stuff. It's time for lunch. Just go right outside. Lunch is right out there.